Well, if you are at home now, and if you could please turn your Bibles to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 20, and our passage this morning starts at verse 22, but I will read just where Paul begins his speech in verse 18. Just a reminder, this is a speech that Paul gives to the elders at Ephesus, and we are in the second message of that. So follow along as I start at verse 18. It says, "And when they came to him, he said to them, 'You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews, how I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God.'" That is the living word of God. Let us just open in a brief word of prayer. Lord, we now come to the word of God with great confidence, knowing that by the work of the Spirit, it is living and it is active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing the soul and spirit of the joints of marrow and discerning the thoughts and intents of the heart. Lord, we cannot hide in front of this word. It does its work and we will be held to account by it. Therefore, Lord, we come with sober hearts, earnest hearts, and a heart ready to learn from you. Lord, bless us. Encourage us and convict us this day for your glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, when I was in grade 6, I was fortunate enough to run in the sort of inter-school cross-country event. And I did reasonably well. I placed okay in the first round of those races that encompassed a number of schools. And then that took me to, I think they might call it the regionals now or something like that. And that encompasses more schools. And there I was with my PE teacher preparing at the age of 11 to run my race. And we were watching the race before ours of the younger age group. And when you're 11 years old, you really have no strategy, or you probably should, but I never did, in terms of how to run my event. I just simply, all right, let's go for it. And we were watching the start of the race, this race before us, and the gun went, and all the children just went straight off in a fanatic fashion. But there was one young man who did not get flustered by what was going on around him. He just started off solid but steady. You could tell his eye was on the finishing line, not being distracted by those around him, and that he was there to run his race. Therefore, it wasn't surprising that he placed very well in the end. And my PE coach said to me, "That is how I want you to run. Keep your eye on the goal run your race and don't get distracted by the noise around you. And if you do, you will finish well. You can tell I've never forgotten what my PE coach told me when I was 11 years old at Bushy Park nearby. But that wisdom has actually served me quite well throughout my life. Yes, a race at the age of 11 really is somewhat, in the whole scheme of things, rather meaningless. But that is the wisdom that we are called to have when it comes to being a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. Keep your eye on the goal. Run your race. Don't get distracted by the noise around you. And if you do, you will finish well. I'm sure you have seen it many times in the Christian life or in the church. Many come to Christ and they are full of zeal and exuberance. And that is a beautiful thing. And that should never be squashed. But then yet, with that same old zeal and exuberance, they seem to peter out, some people. They might, for whatever reason, not come under the discipleship of another older man or woman. And then the testings come and their worldly friends introduce them back into the world and they find the Bible, reading the Bible, just a bit of a drag and the things of Christ not as exciting anymore. They bolt off from the starting line just like all those kids did in a frenetic fashion, but yet then simply peter away. That is not the sort of race we are called to run in the Christian life. The race that we are running is not a sprint, but it is a marathon. And we want to finish well. And I guess the question I want to ask and answer this day is, how might we finish well? How might we finish well in the Christian life? And I believe Paul has something to tell us about this. Well, let us just review for the moment. It is by the providence of the Lord that Paul finds himself coming past Miletus. And he has a desire at that point, thinking, well, I've got this opportunity to give my last kind of a will and testament to the elders at Ephesus. And so we know that he gets a courier to perhaps, or one of the men who was with him, to travel the 70 kilometers to Ephesus and gets the elders back to the shores of the Aegean Sea at Miletus there. And last week we notice that Paul provides them with an example or a model of what it means to be a godly leader. Remember, we looked at that. And there was three things, wasn't there? There was the consistency, that someone who not only just proclaims the truth, but lives by the truth. And then there was that servant attitude, that attitude that realizes that all my service is to the Lord first of all. And then I can walk in humility and tears and trials. But then lastly, there was doctrinal conviction. That as I minister, I am rooted and grounded in the doctrines of the apostles, of the Word of God. And it described the kind of model that godly leadership should have. And that's what he said. I lived 3 years among you, and this is what I was like. But now Paul, and I sense that it's like, he calls them in a bit and he says, guys, listen, just come with me. Just come in because I want to tell you my heart now. I want to tell you what my motivation is for running this race, to minister like that and not to grow weary, but to finish well. Come close. And what he says is both inspirational and it is challenging to our comfortable Australian lifestyle. Look at verse 24, because he says, this is the motivation, but I do not account my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Do you see what Paul is saying? Above everything else in life, gospel faithfulness is more valuable to me than life itself. I ask the question, what does it mean to finish well? It means this, that we would value our faithfulness to the gospel, our obedience to Christ, over life itself. Then, beloved, we will finish well. The big idea is quite long, but let me give it to you. It's that Paul shows us that valuing gospel faithfulness over life in the present allows us to meet future challenges with courage and protects us from guilt of past failures and ensures a crown of glory. If you miss that, look at the Bible study questions under the link in the bulletin next week. You can grab it there. But now I want to look at four major divisions. And the first is this: what is gospel faithfulness? Because it is a word that I've, or a construction that I've given you here. What is gospel faithfulness? Well, Paul had one objective in life, and that was to, you saw it in the verse, to testify everywhere to the gospel of the grace of God. A ministry that he himself received by the Lord Jesus himself. So in his mind, he saw the Lord with his pierced hands and this precious contents of the gospel of the grace of God being given to him. And in the words of the Savior, it was like he was saying, I have redeemed you by the blood of this gospel. I have called you by my name, and I am now entrusting this into your keeping. And would you guard it? Would you nurture it? And would you proclaim it to all whom I direct you to? I've given you this special mandate to testify to the grace of God. Now, would you do it? And we might not be apostles. We might not be the Apostle Paul. In fact, we might not be called to be a preacher or a teacher. But in one sense, we have been given the same kind of challenge or command to guard this precious gospel, to, in the words of Jude 3, contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. In other words, testify to the grace of God. And that will look like doing some form of ministry for God. Whatever that might look like, gospel faithfulness, ministering to God according to the gifts that he's given us. Not worrying about being distracted by noise to the left or the right, being faithful to what he has called you to do with this gospel, as a guardian of the gospel, as an ambassador of the gospel. Gospel faithfulness sees, first of all, the gospel of grace. The gospel is grace. I love this little statement here. It is a statement that, in fact, is not even found in the epistles that Paul writes. But Luke picks it up, and he calls it, it is to testify to God's grace. To testify to the gospel of God's grace. I love this because when Paul hears about the gospel message, this beautiful symphony that he hears almost from heaven, there is one note that stands out, one note that rings out higher and grander than all the notes that are coming forward in the beautiful symphony of the gospel. And it is one that thrills his heart, that he takes it to heart, that transforms him. And it is the note which is called grace. Grace, that beautiful, eminent sound. Why is grace so important? Because there is no salvation, there is no hope, and there is no life outside of grace. The gospel is a pronouncement that God has chosen to deal with humanity, not according to justice, not according to his righteousness, but according to his grace. Oh, we know that all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to our own way. We know, according to Romans 3:23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if God is to be loving, just and righteous, then he ought to punish sin. And that leaves you and I in a very precarious position. What do we do? Because if we're left to our own devices, under the judgment of God, we would perish forever. But then that musical sound, that ringing note calls out grace. For upon him, that is Christ, was laid the iniquity of us all. And covering us with his righteousness, we are found perfect in him. That is not a righteousness that we have on our own, Ephesians 2:8, but it is a gift of God. It is an act of sovereign mercy and pure grace. Free grace to us, but something that costs God dearly. And that cost is met with an expectation for those who are the recipients of that grace. It is with this that Paul acknowledged to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 6:19 to 20. He says, because of this grace, you are not your own. You have been bought with a price. Listen to this. So now glorify God in your body. In other words, testify. Testify, both in your life and in your words, to the gospel of the grace of God. Gospel faithfulness sees that the gospel is as grace and we as witnesses to that grace. So we obtain it, we receive it, and now we become witnesses of it. But not only that. See, gospel faithfulness is not only that we are recipients of grace, but we are entering to a race. Because look what he says. I do not count my life, verse 24, of any value, nor as precious in or to myself, if only I can finish my course. That word course means race. It's used in 2 Timothy 4:7. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. But it's not only race. It is a broader term. And in one sense, what Paul or Luke picks up, the word course, what the translators pick up being course is correct. Right? So it's not just a race. I'm not just simply running a race, but it is a course set for me by God. And to not run that course is both perilous and rebellious. So Paul does not know what is ahead, but he knows precisely that he must present himself to remain faithful. So when Paul wakes up in the morning, he wakes up and says, Lord, what do you have me to do this day? When he goes to the Lord in prayer, he says, not my will, but yours be done. And Lord, give me the grace to do it. Every moment of every day, Paul saw that what was coming at him were not distractions, but divine providences that were part of the course Paul had to run in order for him to be faithful to God's dealings. What others might find as hindrances to God's sovereign plan, Paul rightly saw as instruments to be used for God's sovereign plans. Instruments such as plots of the Jews. They did not persuade or take Paul off course. They were part of the course. Imprisonment, shipwreck, changes to plans, the threat of death. And as we read and as Mike mentioned when he gave the preamble to that verse, the verses that he wrote, Paul said while he was in a jail, he said, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. So Paul sees, just get this, I'm a recipient of grace. I've been given a race, I've been given a course that I need to run. All the things that are coming at me are part of that course. They are not to distract me, but I am to embrace them, I am to trust in the Lord in the midst of them. Now throw it on ourselves. How are you going under COVID? There is much noise. There is much distraction. Samuel Rutherford's words would do us well to heed. He says, duties are ours, events are the Lord's. See, what we are called to be dutiful to the Lord and leave all the events to him. We are called to trust in the Lord. What would it be like if you carried the same attitude Paul carried into your day-to-day, into tomorrow. Always present, serious sense of all-pervading duty to walk faithfully that path appointed for us. What would it look like? I know what it wouldn't look like. Well, actually, I know what it would look like in a negative sense. It would look less of wasting time. There'd be less complaining. There would be a less distraction, less pursuit of trivial things, less falling into sin. I am running a race and I'm not going to be distracted. And COVID crisis is simply part of the race and I am called to run. But my duty is to be faithful. My duty is to be faithful in what He has called me to do. There'd be more joy. There'd be more peace. There'd be more blessing. There'd be more productivity. There'd be more glorifying God. Beloved, however insignificant you believe your task is in what the Lord's called you to do, whether it's home or whether it's at church or whether it's in your workplace, please understand that that is more important than running a nation, than winning a gold medal at the Olympics. Faithfulness to the Lord is more important than anything. No one sees, but Christ sees. And that is what matters. How did the Apostle Paul live like this? See, he placed the value on the right things. Let me read this again, verse 24. I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish the course. This word account, it's a business calculation. He says, if I want to look into the balance sheet of heaven and see Paul there, the only thing that will show value in that balance sheet, and the only balance sheet that will ever matter in life and death, is service to Christ, service to God. Not even, Paul says, life itself is more valuable than that. If I get one day of service to life, that will be of greater value than a whole life spent doing whatever I want to do. What are your values? To get married? To pass your exams? To get into a particular uni course? To be a self-made millionaire? To start a business? To write a book? To have my say? To clear my name? To ensure that people think that I am something good? Please listen to Paul again. The only value that is worth anything in life is to glorify God and live out the gospel in our life by doing His will. That, my friends, is what gospel faithfulness is about. And we want to follow the path of Paul. And therefore, I say and I answer three questions now, and that is, how does gospel faithfulness impact the future? How does gospel faithfulness impact the past and impact eternity? Let's look at the first one. When we are faithful in the day today, we need not fear. We go back to verse 22. Have a look at this. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem constrained by the Spirit. It is interesting, just as an aside. It's like Paul is paralleling Jesus' walk, ominous walk to Jerusalem, and Paul's ominous walk to Jerusalem. We'll have a better look at this in chapter 21. But both are heading to Jerusalem, and both are expecting trouble, but both are constrained by the Spirit. Look at this. It says, I am constrained by the Spirit. The word constrained is didedemos in Greek, or the root is deo. And that simply means to bind together, to bind together. Now, interestingly, as Paul is constrained, bound by the Spirit, heading to Jerusalem, in Acts 21, a prophet Agabus comes. And he says this in verse 11. It says, and coming to us, Agabus took Paul's belt and bound him, same verb, his own feet and hands, and said, thus says the Holy Spirit, this is how the Jews at Jerusalem will bind, same verb, the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. Paul was bound by the Spirit, compelled by the Spirit, and freed from fear of being physically bound. He was free from worrying about what would happen to him because he was captive to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit had so gripped his heart that the fear of disobedience was far more feared than the fear of physical harm. Friends, I felt in a same sort of sense when I was called to the ministry. It was like there was fears ahead. Like, how would the Lord provide? Where would this take me? I'm pretty happy here. You know, I don't know where I'll go. But there was this, in a sense, this overwhelming call of binding by the Spirit that if I failed to obey, that was more fearful than whatever would happen. And so when we are faithfully serving the Lord, we need not fear. The second thing is we can face the unknown, because then he says, I don't even know what will happen to me there. You know, sometimes it's easier to face something when we know what's going to happen. We can brace ourselves. We can prepare ourselves for it. But he might see a small portion of what will happen, but he doesn't know what's behind the door, what's going to happen to him. But see, the person who places the highest value on gospel faithfulness willingly serves the Lord without fear today and then is able to let the chips fall where they like tomorrow and leave it in the Lord. And there is, beloved, freedom in that. We don't need to know the future, but we need to be faithful now. That is better than life. But also, we don't need to flee from what we do know. For Paul does know what's going to happen to him in one sense. And he knows it's going to be awfully painful because look at verse 23. He says, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. Literally, it is chains and tribulation. See, how did the Holy Spirit tell Paul that these tribulations and chains are going to await him? Well, we don't know, but it could have been through prophets in chapter 21 at Tyre and at Caesarea. There are prophets who tell him this. Agabus is one of them. It could have been direct revelation. It could well simply been through experience. I know because I've lived at every city, and every time I'm there, I'm finding tribulations and I'm finding binding. Or it could just been simply that, you know what? The one who willingly takes up his cross and follows Jesus is going to find tribulation. That's what Jesus tells us. So Paul is not under any illusion of what will happen. He knows what's going to happen. But Paul is saying, I know difficulty is before me. It has been ever before me as I started walking in the footsteps of the Savior. But the question is not whether I am going to suffer for the faith. It is whether gospel faithfulness, listen, is better to me than the avoidance of suffering for the Savior. Did you understand that? The fear is whether gospel faithfulness is the most important thing to me rather than suffering. And Paul says when Agabus is binding his hands and everyone's crying in verse 13 of chapter 21, he says, what are you doing? Weeping and breaking my heart. I am ready not only to be imprisoned and even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. Let Polycarp, the bishop of the church of Smyrna in the second century, who was martyred for his faith, speak to us today. See, he was taken into the arena and the proconsul tried to persuade him, saying, have respect for your old age. Swear by the fortune of Caesar and repent. Reproach Christ and I'll let you free. Simple. Polycarp says, 86 years have I served him and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my King and my Savior now? When gospel faithfulness is more valuable than life, then we are freed from the fear of the future and granted courage for the day. Gospel faithfulness impacts the future as we live for him today. The next thing is, how does gospel faithfulness impact the past? As we look back at our past service for the Lord, we can serve in the present with a clear conscience. With a clear conscience, what do I mean? Well, I picked this up last week, and I'll just extrapolate out a little bit more here for us. Look at verse 25 to 27. And he says, "And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again." Now, Paul is saying that I believe that this will be the end. I will not see you again. We do find that actually in the epistles, he does go back to that area. He did not die in Jerusalem, as we know. But then he goes and says in verse 26, "Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God." See, Paul is saying that there is an obligation upon me to serve the Lord continually, as it is on all of us. And as I do this, I am fulfilling my obligation and my debt to the lost and the saved alike. Because as I do not live in the present from regrets, so he's faithful today, and that will amount up for him no guilt, no regret of past events. He will not have, as it were, the blood of anyone on his head, as it states. And the question I have is that if I fail to obey the Spirit's promptings and guidings, and in so fail to minister the gospel to a person with whom I believe that the Spirit has, in a sense, given me opportunity to share, am I guilty of their blood? That's a fair question to ask. And I'll give you a short answer, and that is yes. And I would say, though, who has not done that? And that's not to dismiss it. I'm just simply stating. Who has not been faithful in sharing the truth when we ought to? My responsibility is to serve the Lord. And when I don't, I'm disobedient to him. And there are ramifications. Will it mean that someone won't come to the Lord if I don't share? Well, in one sense, no, because God will save all of his people. He will do it. Whether he uses you or me, he will do it. Will I be punished if I fail to be responsible for the opportunities that he gives me? Well, we know that he does not punish his children. He disciplines us, he chastises us, but he will not punish us. How can he punish us when all of our punishment has been dealt on Christ? So no Christian will be punished for their sins. Ultimately, there are ramifications for their sins. There is discipline for their sins. And that is why 1 John 1:9 is so precious to us, because it tells us that he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But see, like any work of the Spirit upon our life, if we don't obey the Spirit, we are disobeying God and we are hardening our heart to the Spirit's work upon us. And you know what happens when you harden your heart? You harden it even more and more. And it could it be that as we continually harden our heart, that we get to a place where we realize actually the Spirit was not even in us? And so what Paul is saying here is that, you know, well, how can I get away from this? How can I not be guilty of this? Well, I think we are to know the whole counsel of God. We are called to know the whole counsel of God. Then we can adequately proclaim to both unsaved and saved alike. But we are called to be faithful to him and to value that more than life. I look at it like this. Say there was a king, and the king goes out to the village and takes a beggar off the street, and he brings him into the king's palace, and he says, "You know what? I am actually adopting you as my child. I'm putting upon you the robe of kingship. I'm putting upon you the ring of sonship. But I've got one thing I want you to do. This grace that I've bestowed upon you, I want you to take my message of grace. Now here it is. And I want you to go back out into that city, and I want you to proclaim it. But you've got to know it. If you don't know it, how can you proclaim it?" And what would happen if that beggar or that pauper goes out and he puts it aside and says, "Oh, look, I'm loving this life. The king's palace, I'm part of the family. And I'm living my life." Would that be obedient as a someone who's been saved by grace? No, of course it wouldn't. And what the expectation would be is that that person would read the word, read the message of grace that has been given to them, and prepare themselves to be able to share such grace to other people. That's going to look different in different ways, but it's an obligation on all of us, and that will protect us from current guilt. How does gospel faithfulness impact eternity? See, Paul understood, let's just back up. Paul understood that his life was a life of grace that entered him into a race, and that was a course set for him. He understood that all things that came upon that course were of the divine plan of the Lord, and he was able to go through them. He didn't need to fear them because all he needed to worry about was faithfulness now. And as he was faithful, and as he looked to the Lord and served the Lord and valued that more than life itself, he was then able to live with a pure conscience knowing he's been faithful in the past. And if he hadn't have been, he's got the blood of Christ that can take away all sin. But then he realizes that there is an end to this race, is there not? That at the race there is a goal. And he mentions this in 2 Timothy 4:8. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. There is an end to the race. There is an end to the course. And that end comes as the King of Glory comes with his reward to bestow it upon Paul, because he's valued faithfulness greater than life itself. And then the King would bestow it upon all who follow in the same footsteps of Paul. I like what Jim Elliot said, that man at the age of 29 who died at the hands of a spear from one of the tribe in the Orca Indians in Ecuador. And he said this: he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Jim Elliot's received his reward. Paul has received his reward. And my prayer is that we would look forward to ours and live in the light of that today. Is there anything better to live for? No wonder Paul said, I do not account my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, if only I may finish the course. I'm sure you want to finish well, but are you on track? And may I ask, what is in your balance sheet? If you look at it, what is there? Is it simply service to the Lord? Perhaps a good question to ask is, if you had, 2 weeks, 2 months, 1 year to live, would there be anything you would quickly wipe off that balance sheet? Is there anything that you'd quickly remove and replace it with service to the Lord as the greatest thing? If we are really the Lord's, then I would hope that whether penned in crisis or penned in death would not change a thing, that our balance sheet would be fixed. Service to the Lord is my greatest aim in life. But we need to settle the question today. If you have not settled that question, my prayer and my call to you is that you would repent, because you are seeking other things, and that you would say, Lord, help me. Give me grace to see that service to the King of Kings is better than life itself. And if you are not even a child of God, the gates of heaven have been opened to you, that you can receive the gospel of grace for your life today. That if you would only repent of your sins in humility and receive the gift of salvation that is offered to you freely in Christ, cost the Lord everything, it is free to you, and that you would embrace that, receive by faith, and begin to serve him today. May the Lord's Spirit give us the courage and conviction to place the service of Christ as the whole value, as the greatest value than life itself. Just think what would happen through this church and in this city if we began to do that today. Let us pray. Lord, you who gave up your life to give us life deserves nothing less than full commitment, faithful service to you. But never, Lord, out of coercion or enforcement, but rather out of love for you, out of a desire for you. May Christ be our highest attainment in life and death. May his service be our greatest desire, seeking the reward directly from the pierced hands of our Lord when we would meet him in heaven. Lord, please protect us from settling into the dangerous belief that part obedience, part faithfulness is accepted in your sight or is even right. Lord, I pray that as we run our race, let us be known as a people with no other aim, no other burning desire than to be faithful to the Lord today and then tomorrow for your praise and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.